In September 2001, I presented a manifesto, a performance that in effect announced the birth of Mama. Mama was not born overnight. Its gestation has taken many years. It was germinated by experiences and events of the 1960s and 70s, from which a slow maturation and filtration occurred, resulting in this philosophy. I grew up in the north of England in an era when the class system was still strong and everyone was expected to know their place. For me, that meant I should have no aspirations other than marriage and children. However, things were changing and young people were beginning to feel empowered. I secretly applied to art college. My headmaster found out and was furious. Apart from my mum, I had no support. In fact, teachers, family and friends tried their best to discourage me, but it didn't work. And somehow, against all odds, I was allowed to go. When I walked into the studio, easels were already set up and there was much anticipation. Suddenly, the tutor stormed in, declaring that we were already artists and therefore would not need to be taught. A violent rage followed, in which the tutor smashed television sets onto a rubbish pile and then stormed out again. The bewildered students hesitantly took up charcoal and paper and began to draw. Later they returned, only to tear up the work before leaving one more time. This treatment went on for 3 days. Individuals would be singled out for interrogation while others watched on nervously. This interrogation took the form of ranting, verbal abuse, and physical intimidation. This was my introduction to art college. It continued in this fashion for many months to come. We were caught up in a neo-Dadaist experiment intended to purge us of our conditioning in a manner that almost amounted to brainwashing. And just like the Dadaist had originally intended, it left us raw and open. We soon learnt to argue and defend our work. If we didn't, the abuse continued. Outwardly, I began to comply, but inwardly I rebelled against them with an internal dialogue that reframed their antics into methods that could open the mind without having to destroy it first. This was the beginning of Mama. The Dada movement was short-lived, an inevitable consequence of its destructive power. But in pushing and testing art to its limits, it created a legacy that lives on. The Dadaists created new approaches, methods and values in art making, which liberated artists and has been the source of inspiration behind many new art movements and philosophies, including Mama. Mama leans towards Yoko Ono, whose work is not outwardly aggressive, but nevertheless challenges its audiences by undermining their compliancy. She often turns the viewer into a participator in a manner that appears to relinquish the artist's control, but in fact places the viewer in a situation where they have to confront their own values. As I was growing up, I was only too aware how the working classes were kept in their place by elitist systems that provided little opportunity for change. I could see parallels in the art world. Many art institutions and practitioners have propagated an elitist environment that continues to devalue and scorn the public's ignorance. Ignorance does not equate to stupidity, but is simply a lack of knowledge. I wanted to understand why so many people felt alienated from art world and have informative conversations with them to that end. For 3 months, I literally made an exhibition of myself. In this way, I could take art everywhere, into supermarkets, schools, public transport, banks, and more. I also targeted art venues, such as the Art Gallery of WA, where I unofficially exhibited myself. The work was endorsed by the gallery guides, who quite independently brought their groups over and discussed me as a living artwork. Making an exhibition of myself enabled me to tap into people from all walks of life. The phrase, "I don't know much about art," was common, but what was really disturbing was the frequency that people covered their mouths and took a step back as they said it. One has to ask why. As an artist, I felt a personal responsibility to find ways to reach out to those who felt alienated, not by dumbing down the work, that would be pointless and insulting. I developed many intuitive answers to this problem, which I decided to put to the test. I took over an abandoned alcove at a busy intersection within ECU's Mount Lawley campus and converted it into an art space, where I began a series of twice-weekly performances. These performances were to continue for 2.5 years, in which I investigated 7 key issues. 1, empowering those debilitated by lack of formal knowledge by utilising intuitive and cultural knowledges. 2, allow access to difficult art by providing a context. 3, provide a process of familiarisation. 4, use of curiosity as a means of engagement. 5, allow the viewer a means of validating their own interpretations. 6, find ways to demystify the art process. 7, explore the relationship between artist and viewer. In these performances, more and more challenges many of the issues that were brought up while making an exhibition of myself. The following exhibition demonstrates how this experience has informed my present work. 3 works were faced outwards into the laneway, placed there for the gallery shy. Another window was painted white. Visitors were invited to join me for tea and biscuits. Inevitably, crumbs from the biscuits and marks from the teacups would remain on the table. As I begin to trace these marks, it dawns on them that their actions were going to be part of an artwork, whereupon interesting conversations about art and its processes naturally emerged. They were offered an introduction, which firstly took them to the painted window, where I scratched off paint following the brush marks. They were intrigued by the intricate patterns formed by this process. I explained, not all art has to be deep and meaningful. Some are about colour and form. I invited them into my world, a floating three-dimensional painting. On the backs were more paintings, quite different from those on the front, enhancing the dynamics of being on the inside. They were all narrative works, but without a definitive story. They could bring their own experiences and cultural values to it, which would give them their own meaning. To explain, I pointed to the large wall painting, saying, "The first person who saw this was a farmer and asked if the woman was reaping her crops. The second, a housewife who thought she was doing the laundry." They asked questions and discussed their own readings of the work. Since there was no right or wrong answers, they gained confidence in this process. I was quite overcome by the commitment they gave to their viewing and their emotional responses, some saying they wanted to cry. It was gratifying that they trusted themselves and me enough to immerse themselves so deeply into the work that it affected this response. Many of the visitors stopped at every work, studying each with great intensity. Some even did a second circuit. Others had energetic discussions. Some people came back a second and even a third time. It was an overwhelming response. But the one I valued the most was a man who came in saying he didn't get art. He just wanted shelter from the rain. So I gave him some tea and biscuits. He came with me to the window as I scratched some paint off. He walked with me into the three-dimensional painting and then asked me to explain the first print. I explained, as I had done to others, he could simply enjoy the mark making or create a narrative for himself. He started to scrutinise the work and got drawn in. He studied it with great interest. On realising the time, he rushed off to feed the meter and then came back. He went from one work to another, giving insightful comments as he did. He kept saying, "I don't know much about art," but his perceptual journey of discovery was simply amazing. He might have thought he didn't get art, but I beg to differ. And so does Marmal.